What's the point of Agile? Why use Agile project management? Now, in order to answer this question of why Agile, I'd like us to first consider some of the basic characteristics of a traditional project management approach. So let's imagine that we're building a bridge. Now, clearly, this is a hugely complicated scenario. Nobody could pretend that this is a simple project. It's a massive undertaking requiring experts to analyse and design what we need and many different people and different project phases, and it's going to cost millions. But even though it is indeed complicated, the laws of physics and engineering haven't changed for, I don't know, hundreds of years. There is a lot of established best practices that we can draw on here. I mean, many, many different bridges have already been built all over the world. And we're also, quite importantly, very confident that we do actually need a bridge. So there are things that we do know even before the project starts. We have a very tangible physical thing that we're producing. You know, it's industrial work, isn't it? And so for this kind of project, we will spend some considerable time up front gathering requirements for our bridge. So this is going to be a complete list of what we need the end result to achieve. So how many lanes and what capacity of traffic it needs to support and whether we need pedestrian access and a million other things, I'm sure. And then based on that list of requirements, we will design a solution. And note, we won't start designing our solution until we have finished gathering and documenting our requirements, because our civil engineers are going to be coming up with a design based on those requirements. And then we'll be able to use that design to understand exactly what resources and materials and budget we'll need. And so we'll be able to map it all out and plan the project in great detail. And we'll be able to predict that, say, we're going to have completed the project in, I don't know, 3 years, 4 months' time. And for that reason, this traditional project management approach is sometimes referred to as predictive or even plan-based. We're following the project plan. But anyway, having planned our bridge project, then of course we're going to start building the thing. And within this part of the project, there will be lots of different phases and it's going to last several years. So the rectangle sizes here of each stage don't necessarily represent the duration involved in each stage. I'm more interested in illustrating that the previous stage has to be completed before we can start the next stage. You know, we can't design our bridge until we've finished defining the requirements. We can't put together a project plan until we've got a design. We can't start building it until we've got a plan in place. And so for this reason, a traditional predictive, plan-based approach is sometimes known as a waterfall approach. Each phase here flows on to the next one. And just to finish it off, we'll also need to test our bridge and make sure that it passes highway regulations for safety or whatever. And then finally, we can open the bridge to cars and lorries 3 or 4 years on from when we first started gathering requirements. Phew! So this kind of traditional approach might be described as predictive or plan-based or waterfall. But when we do describe a project as being predictive, it's not because it's simple. This is a big, long, complicated project. It's predictive because it is possible to gather all of the requirements up front. It is possible to plan in advance how the project is going to unroll. And we are confident that those requirements are not going to change. I mean, we're not worried that, I don't know, flying cars will come to the market in a few years' time, thus meaning we're not going to need the bridge. Do you see what I mean? We have such a high level of confidence in the detailed specification of the thing that we're building that it makes a lot of sense to put a lot of effort up front with the requirement gathering and the design and the planning before we start building a single thing. And so with this kind of traditional approach, changes are frankly discouraged. If we're halfway through building the bridge and then somebody has the bright idea for a cycle path or something, then that's going to give us a problem. We really should have thought about that at the beginning when we were gathering requirements. Of course, there are going to be hiccups along the way. That means we do need to rejig things. But the point is, only changes which are essential to the completion of our bridge will be allowed. And any changes are going to be subject to a rigorous change control process and will be monitored very closely. All in all though, for our bridge, because we can collect and analyse requirements with a large degree of confidence up front, in this scenario, yes, a waterfall or a predictive or a plan-based approach is a good choice. Marvellous. Let's imagine now though that this is a software development project. So I'm going to keep those different stages of the waterfall, but change the final one here at the bottom right to releasing to end users. So let's imagine this time we're developing a groundbreaking new language learning app to be used on a browser or on a phone or maybe even on a smartwatch. And I don't know about you, but I'm immediately seeing a problem with using a waterfall or a predictive plan-based approach here. Because firstly, the customer's not going to see any deliverable at all until the app is completely finished with all its bells and whistles. You know, all of the features we decided on at the beginning, they won't see any value until 2 years or so after the idea was first born. And that's going to be problematic because unlike building our bridge, where we really are pretty sure that flying cars aren't going to replace regular cars in the next 10 years, so we are still going to need a bridge, the world of software, as an example, is much less predictable. It's a chaotic world out there. I mean, who knows exactly what users will need in 2 years' time or what devices they'll be using? Technology changes all the time. We cannot confidently gather requirements up front at the beginning of the project. Frankly, we might be unsure what the next 3 months bring, let alone the next 3 years. And also, what happens if we run out of money here, halfway through the build? We're going to end up with absolutely nothing to show for it, no working software. And so this traditional or waterfall or predictive plan-based approach where those requirements are confidently gathered up front and we're producing something physical is not going to work for us here, for our software development project. And so I imagine you probably know where I'm going with this, because this is where an agile approach makes better sense. But you will see that I've got the term adaptive here. Well, this is a general term for a project management approach that's kind of the opposite of what we just looked at. It's going to be useful to us when requirements are likely to change. And what an adaptive approach means is, instead of doing all of the planning up front like we did with our bridge, while we will have an overall vision of what we want to achieve, so in this case, a language learning app, if we're taking an adaptive approach, we only plan in detail for the very near future. And we build in feedback loops and reviews to take learnings from current outcomes in order to improve what our best next steps are going to be. We don't produce an exhaustive beginning to end plan. We don't try and predict every detail of the product we're building. We expect those details to emerge once we start building the thing. Wow, imagine taking that approach with the bridge. That's not going to end well, is it? Because clearly we can't open the bridge to cars and lorries until it is fully complete and safety tested and whatnot. A software application is a very different beast to something industrial like a bridge. But you might be wondering where the term agile comes in here. Well, while we could get ourselves wrapped up in different definitions here, suffice it to say that adaptive is the general term for a flexible approach, which is the opposite of the waterfall approach, so we're prepared to learn and adapt as we go along. And agile is a term more often specifically associated with developing software in an adaptive way. And agile is the term that I'm going to be using moving forward. So, how did agile come about then? Well, in terms of a very brief history, I'm going to point you to this PMI document here, which I have popped into the skill for you if you're interested. But you can see here that Agile was born in around 2001, and it came from a group of software developers who decided to put their heads together to try and address the frustrations of trying to apply sequential project management methods, you know, like we talked about before, the traditional plan-based approach. Oh, that didn't really work for software development. So these folks put their heads together. They needed something that allowed for changes. You can see that there. And also, if I just scroll through, they also wanted to be able to allow for testing and modification without waiting for the final end product. And the way they did this, or one of the key parts of Agile, is to divide production up into small components called iterations, which we will see in a second. And you will also see here that although Agile was first evolved in order to address problems with software development, we do now see Agile methods being used across different industries. But I'll leave you to take a look at that in more detail if you're interested. But let me just briefly show you how Agile can help us when developing software. So I've already said that we only plan in detail for the very near future. And the idea is, with Agile, we often develop in these short bursts of work. That's what the PMI document we just saw refers to as iterations. And these iterations, these bursts of work effort, are typically a couple of weeks or so each. I'm going to use 2 weeks in my example here, but it could be 1 week or 3 weeks or even four. And we're only going to plan in detail for that very next burst of work or iteration. And the goal is that we do produce a working version of the software product after every iteration. This is described as developing incrementally. That means we're building the product successively. So we're adding more and more functionality with each iteration. We're kind of layering on the capabilities of the software product that we're making. And so all of this means that if we want to, we can deploy it to users after each iteration and get feedback from them straight away. And so within each iteration, we do just enough of the work from each of those big sequential phases that we saw with the waterfall or the traditional approach. We do just enough to complete the work for that iteration. So just enough planning, just enough building, just enough testing and whatever in order to complete the features we've decided to work on in that 2-week work effort, that 2-week iteration. Now, because each iteration is so short and we are getting user feedback so fast, we're learning what works and what users want as we go along, rather than having to anticipate it all up front like we did when we were building our bridge. So we're inspecting and adapting with each iteration. And again, because these work cycles, these iterations are so short, we can, if we need to, change direction very, very easily. If market conditions suddenly dictate that a particular feature is of higher priority than we had originally thought, then no problem. We can work on that in the very next iteration. It's so much better than sticking with something that isn't working. It's much more effective to make adjustments as we go along and as the situation changes. So to give you an example, with our language learning app, let's say we might start off in our first release of the app with simply a single language, let's say French, teaching only in the present tense. So we get feedback, and then based on that, we add, I don't know, recap quizzes in the next iteration. And while we had thought that we would probably add Spanish next, but wait, let's say that there's been some major world event which has led to a surge in demand for learning Ukrainian. And so we decide, instead of adding Spanish, that we add the Ukrainian language next. Now, that was a bit contrived, but do you see the difference here compared to our traditional approach? This agile approach is expecting changes. We are flexible enough to be able to change direction quickly. Those new ideas are embraced, and we don't even try and define all of the requirements up front. And I know it does feel as though we're kind of making it up as we go along. The key point is we expect to have working software at the end of each iteration. We do all of the design and build and test required to have that working software at the end of each burst of work, which means we can get feedback and then reprioritize what we do next based on what we're learning from that feedback. But look, this skill is just about the basics. I don't need you to worry about the detail just yet. And so let's wrap up with our key takeaways from this video. So yes, traditional project management uses a sequential approach, which means that projects will usually only deliver something of value at the end of the entire project or at the end of each major phase. And frankly, changes are not welcome. Whereas agile project management evolved in order to address software development, and it allows for and welcomes changes. It also allows for testing and feedback without waiting till the very end of the project. We don't have to wait for the final end product. We inspect and adapt as we go along. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from CBT Nuggets. Oh, and also, if you're new to IT or are interested in an IT career, visit cbtnuggets.com and sign up for a free trial.